no more is a natural human tendency, and when this gets equipped with the tools like logic, reasoning, or experimentation, so on and so forth, what comes out is the science. And science is the beautiful approach which we humans have with us to understand and unleash the secrets and beauty of the nature. So having said this, on behalf of the Department of Biosciences and on behalf of the Mangalore University, I extend a warm welcome to all of you to this UGC-sponsored national seminar on research trends in frontier areas of biological sciences. Welcome you all. So without further delay, I straight away request our chairperson, Dr. Prashant, Professor Prashant Naik, and convener of this program, Professor Monica Sadananda, and coordinator of our UGC SAP program, Professor Chandrakala Shanai, and all the bio class representatives of biosciences departments, students, to welcome and escort the dignitaries onto the dais, please. We have with us today the chief guest of today's function, Professor A.R. Reddy. He is a fellow of Indian Academy of Sciences, and he is the founder and 2 times vice chancellor of Yogi Vemana University, and he is the chairman and director of ATGC Biotech, and he is the professor emeritus at the Central University of Hyderabad. And we have the president of today's function, Professor Kishori Nayak K, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Mangalore Universities. I request the students and the convener and the coordinator and the chairperson to escort the dignitaries onto the dais, please. And we welcome all the speakers, Professor Ramachandra sir, Professor Prashant Naik sir, to welcome the gathering.
Namaskara. A very good morning to everyone. It's my great privilege to welcome the guests and gathering on this special occasion of National Seminar on Recent Trends in Frontier Areas of Biological Sciences, being organized under the auspices of UGC Special Assistant Program. At the outset, on behalf of our university and our Honorable Vice Chancellor, I extend a warm welcome to Professor A.R. Reddy. I would like to introduce Professor A.R. Reddy for our August gathering. Professor Arjula Ramachandra Reddy, born in remote village Tarikopula of Telangana state, has arisen to the position of a distinguished scientist, educationist, and academic administrator. He has been honored with appointment twice as Vice Chancellor of Yogi Vemana University. His advanced scientific research work in the field of genetics and biotechnology of rice and maize got recognition worldwide. After obtaining PhD from Osmania University in genetics, he was postdoctoral fellow at Iowa State University and John Hopkins University, one of the world topest university. He then joined as a faculty in the University of Hyderabad in December 1978 and has been serving the university till to date with great distinction and dedication. Under his guidance, 23 students received PhD degrees and 17 MPhil degrees. Professor Reddy's lab focuses on research on genetics and genomics of drought tolerance in rice. His world-class laboratory, which he has built from scratch, has been active in sequencing a large number of rice genes and making them available in public domain. Dr. Reddy has attracted funding from highly reputed international organizations such as Three Rockefeller Foundation, European Union, CGIAR organization, besides national organizations including DBT, UGC, ICAR, etc., to carry out research on drought and rice. Professor Reddy played an important role in establishing several national and international collaborations and developing advanced research programs using cutting-edge technologies such as functional genomics, association genetics, and transgenic plants. As a resource person, he traveled across the world, including USA, Mexico, Canada, Italy, Philippines, Thailand, China, Singapore, Indonesia, Australia, New Zealand, Malaysia, etc. He has been visiting professor at the prestigious Max Planck Institute, Germany, and Purdue University, USA. He has been conferred with many recognitions, few to mention here: Fellow Indian Academy of Sciences, Fellow Alexander von Humboldt Foundation, Germany, Carrier Biotechnology Fellowship of Rockefeller Foundation, USA, World Food Institute Scholarship, USA, HEH Nizam Scholarship, so on and so forth. He served as a science panel member for Government of UK, for which he was the only scientist from India in 2007 and 8. He has been associated with several major committees of the Government of India, including chairman and co-chair for panel member for the past 30 years on plant and crop biotechnology, regulation of genetically modified crops, National Task Force on Agri-Biotechnology, like that. He is also serving in the international science panels addressing food security in developing countries. In recognition of his outstanding scientific contribution, he has been elected to the Indian Academy of Sciences. He is also a reviewer of several international scientific journals. In summary, he has dedicated the best part of his academic life on teaching science and carrying out high-quality research on improving drought tolerance of in rice by using advanced tools of genetics, genomics, and biotechnology. With this brief introduction, once again, on all behalf of you, I extend a warm welcome to Professor A.R. Reddy. I request our Honorable Vice Chancellor to offer a bouquet as a token of respect and gratitude. Our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Kishori Nayak Madam, is with us presiding over the function. I would like to briefly introduce Madam. Professor Kishori Nayak is serving as Professor of English and has chaired the Department of PG Studies and Research in English in our university for several times since 1998. She was the founding director of the Center for Women's Study and held its charge for about 10 years. She was a recipient of Government of India Merit Scholarships, Gold Medal, and rank during her graduate and postgraduate days. She holds an advanced diploma in German language and also is a Vidwat in Hindustani vocal music, having topped in the state in the special music exams. She was a Commonwealth postdoctoral fellow at the University of Warwick, UK, during 2001. To carry out research on feminism and multiculturalism. Dr. Nayak has been abroad several times as a Rotary GSE team and also to present research articles at various international forums. She has completed a UGC major research project, which she has focused on feminism in developing world. Recently, in 2016, she has been awarded another UGC major research project on multicultural women's life narratives. Dr. Nayak has organized several regional and national events in the area during her directorship in the Center for Women's Studies at Mangalore University. She has conducted the state-level convention of women activists to protest the increasing violence against women in the aftermath of the Nirbhaya incident. With her constant effort and able leadership, for the first time in the state, it was possible to include the gender equity as a compulsory component of the general studies course at the undergraduate level in Mangalore University in 2006. She has authored two textbooks on gender equity, both in Kannada and English, besides publications of the proceedings of colloquium, conferences, workshop that she convened those conferences. Under UGC special scheme, Dr. Nayak has carried out many training programs and workshops on capacity building for women managers in higher education. She has also carried out a project to address various issues of Anganwadi workers during the 11th plan. Currently, Madam is serving as the acting Vice Chancellor of Mangalore University. With her able leadership, the university has successfully organized many events, including Yakshagana Award Ceremony, Foundation of Bihari Adhyayana Pita, Workshop on Animal Conservation, and the seminars, including the present one. I feel really proud and happy once again to welcome Madam on all behalf of you. I request Dr. Monika Sadananda, the convener of the seminar, to offer a bouquet as a token of respect and gratitude. So we have eminent resource persons with us today, already have arrived the campus. First of all, I would like to welcome Dr. T.V. Ramachandra, Professor, Center for Environmental Sciences, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. I request our Honorable Vice Chancellor to offer a bouquet. Dr. T.V. Ramachandra to receive the bouquet. I extend a warm welcome to another resource person, Dr. Kajal Chakrabarty, Senior Scientist, CMFRI, Kochi. I request our Honorable Vice Chancellor to offer a bouquet to Dr. Kajal Chakrabarty. Dr. Bipasha Bose, yet to arrive for the talk. Okay, Madam will join later. I will also welcome Dr. Bishapa Bose in her absence for the time being. I extend my heartfelt welcome to faculty members of our sister departments, other departments, research scholars, guest lecturers, and my own colleagues, and most importantly, Professor Monika Sadananda and Professor Chandrakala Sharne, who are the key persons behind organizing this particular seminar. And most importantly, the participants, particularly who came from different departments and colleges. No program is complete without the press and media people. They are always supportive to our university in giving the wide publicity for all positive activities. I extend a heartfelt welcome to all the press persons who are here. I welcome each and every person gathered here. Thank you, one and all. I wish the program a grand success with your full support.
Thank you, sir, for the welcome address. And now I request all the dignitaries to inaugurate this national seminar by lighting the lamp. Thank you. I now request Professor Monica Sadananda, the convener of this national seminar, to brief about the national seminar.
Currently, the department is privileged. The Department of Biosciences is privileged to be recognized under two programs. That is the DST FIST program and the UGC SAP program. Under the auspices of the UGC SAP program, the department has organized this national seminar on research trends in frontier areas of biological sciences. A seminar comes together when we have renowned experts who are willing to come all the way to Mangalore University and speak on their research work and its applications. It was possible today to have this national seminar because Professor A.R. Reddy, Professor T.V. Ramachandra, Dr. Kajal Chakravarti happily agreed to come. A seminar also comes together when young researchers are eager to present their research work to the scientific community. Under the SAP program, we have thrust areas of research as aquatic biology and bioremediation, physiology and ethnopharmacology. A further mandate of the SAP program is to invite meritorious students who have come today from neighboring colleges to participate in this seminar. Overall, we have representation from various states in the country, including Karnataka, Kerala, Telangana, Uttar Pradesh, Delhi, Gujarat, etc. It is our sincere desire that all will benefit academically from this program. This is the second seminar we are organizing under the UGC SAP program. The last one was held in the year 2018 in February, where we collaborated with the Royal Society of Chemistry London to have a two-day event. This time we are honored by the presence of our speakers. We thank the delegates who have come from neighboring colleges and institutions, and we thank all those who are presenting posters today. We wish the program all the success. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I request our chief guest, Professor A.R. Reddy, sir, to release the book of abstracts. Request our chief guest, Professor A.R. Reddy, sir, to address the gathering.
Two great personalities with us today, Professor K.R. Sridhar and Professor M. Krishnamurthy, who are one of the founders of the department, are also with us today to support the program. I extend a warm welcome on all behalf of you. Thank you.
Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Kishori Nayak, convener and organizing secretary of this conference, the officials of the, or academic officials of the university, delegates, students, and others, ellariki namaskara. This is not the first time that I came here in this auditorium. This is my second talk in one or the other aspects of biology. As I see, by default, most of the students are girls. This is happening more and more in all premier institutions. And one thing is certain, when there are more girl students in a university, that university will be peaceful. I could see that. As a vice chancellor, with my experience, I can tell you that. And also a little bit serious. Now, why did I come here to speak today with one call from Monica? The reason is I like this place. I was associated with your vision document of this university. Three or four meetings, I was co-chairman of that, writing the vision for next 20 years or so. And I come there to assess myself what we wrote in that vision and where this university is going. This is just a side story. In any case, I'm honored to be present today to kickstart this seminar in the areas of frontiers of biology. Biology today has become borderless. It is not only interdisciplinary, but it is highly interconnected. The airtight departments dealing with biology of any kind of organism are not going to make much progress. At the same time, we cannot forget the fundamental pillars of biology, like botany, zoology, and all those. It may sound less romantic to be working in botany directly or zoology, but without that grounding, you're not going to go too far. That's for sure. With experience, I can tell you that. And one of the binding subjects of biology is genetics. It's all pervasive. Whichever branch of biology you work with, ultimately, when the critical questions come, you need genetic answers. So seminars like these will integrate biology, and therefore it's highly useful for the students. That's the reason why I came, and I will try to do that today. On my behalf, I thank, and I'm honored to be here, and I thank the organizers and this university for giving me this opportunity. I wish this conference or this seminar all the success. Thank you.
Thanks very much, sir, for the address. Now it's time for presidential remarks. I request our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Kishori Naik K, to address us.
Honored chief guest, inaugurator of today's program, Professor Arkula Reddy. Resource persons, Dr. Ramakrishna and Dr. Kajal. Chairman of the department, convener of the program, and well, others. Dignitaries of the dais, delegates, students, friends, ladies and gentlemen. It's my privilege as the acting vice chancellor to make the presidential remarks. It was a pleasure to meet and interact with Professor Reddy yesterday evening. The kind of inspirational words that he spoke. I think it is important for students to meet models of achievement and be inspired by them. Maybe I'm saying this partly because of my own interest in life narratives. Of course, it's on multicultural women's narratives, but I do read a lot of men's narratives also. I was recently browsing through Venki Ramakrishnan's memoir, The Gene Machine. And I have read a few things like Siddhartha Mukherjee, I think he is, the Pulitzer Prize winning, the Emperor of Maladies. I mean, I was motivated to read that partly because of some personal tragedies in my life. But then I enjoyed that book for the kind of English it had, the kind of narrative techniques it had, and also the science that went into it. I may have opted for literature to specialize in, but I was very interested, as I was telling Professor Reddy, in genetics also when I was at the high school level. It was the diagrams that deterred me from, you know, going for science or even medicine, which was available to me next door in Manipal. I grew up in Manipal. So I think it's very important for students to attend seminars. I think it's important for students to read. Yeah, read maybe on Kindle if you don't want to read, these boring paper books. But If we read and if we are aware of not only our own subject areas, there's a tendency to sideline or denigrate other disciplines. But interdisciplinarity is becoming more and more important in today's world. And well, if I am to as a literature person, if I am quoting Siddhartha Mukherjee and his book Emperor of Maladies, and I also read his book on the gene, of course that was about psychology also, yeah, psychiatric disorders. So then, and that was what motivated me to read it. So interdisciplinarity is also important, and the sciences should not denigrate the humanities, and the humanities should also not keep the sciences at arm's length or whatever. I think particularly the biosciences and the kind of implications it has for our everyday life in terms of environment, in terms of disease, problems associated with diseases and how to solve them, even pollution and waste management, all these are very important. And I hope our students, even though many of them are girls, I hope they will rise to great heights. And I think for that, you need to read women's life narratives also. There are books on women in science. I think I remember hearing about the vice chancellor, one of the vice chancellors of the Hyderabad Central University, himself writing a book on women in science. So read and aspire is my message to the girls in particular, and also to the boys for that matter. Yeah, read and aspire. And do not be deterred by the kind of competition that is there in the sciences. Venki Ramakrishnan brings out all the politics of science. There is a lot of politics in science, like there is in everyday life. And we need to be aware that this is a part of life, and in spite of that, we need to go beyond this and, achieve. I wish the seminar success. Congratulations to the department for organizing this. It has been one of the departments that has been organizing many things every year over the years. We have our veterans here, yeah? And I congratulate all of you. I wish you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for your valuable address. Your motivational words reminds me of the words of Denzel Washington, who once said in his talk, "Don't just aspire a living, aspire to make a difference." So with this, we are almost at the end of the inaugural ceremony. Now I request Professor Chandrakala Shanai, the coordinator of our UGC SAP program, to propose a vote of thanks.
Invitees and participants, good morning to all of you. Gratitude is the expression of heart. It's my privilege to express gratitude on behalf of Department of Biosciences and on behalf of Mangalore University to all those who have supported in organizing the inaugural function of today's event. At the onset, I would like to thank with immense pleasure the President of Inaugural Function, Professor Kishori Nayak K, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Mangalore University, for her valuable presidential remarks. Thank you, Madam, for your gracious presence and your kind words of appreciation. I request Professor Prashant Nayak, Chairman, Department of Biosciences, to present a memento as a token of our love and respect to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Kishori Nayak. Thank you, Dr. Prashant. Let me thank with great honor the chief guest of inaugural function, Dr. Arjula Ramachandra Reddy, Fellow of Indian Academy of Sciences, Professor Emeritus in Central University of Hyderabad, former Vice Chancellor of Yogi Vemana University, Hyderabad, Chairman and Director, ATGC Biotech and Adjunct Faculty of Mangalore University, for inaugurating the seminar by igniting the light of knowledge and for delivering the keynote address and also for release of Book of Abstracts. Thank you, sir, for gracing this occasion in spite of your busy schedule. May I request Professor Monica Sadanal, Convener, National Seminar and Deputy Coordinator of UGC SAP program, to present a memento to our chief guest, Dr. A.R. Reddy. Dr. Krishnamurthy, the guests of today's function, for gracing. These are our former professors of Department of Biosciences. Thank you, sir, for gracing this occasion. I also owe my thanks to the invitees, chairpersons, and faculty members of various PG departments of Mangalore University for responding to our invitation by sending their presence, by sending their messages as well as by their presence. Today's seminar is mainly oriented towards the enlightenment of meritorious students of biological sciences. Thanks to all registered participants who have gathered here in large number. I also thank PRO of Mangalore University, Dr. Priya, and the press and media reporters for coverage and wide publicity to the seminar. Finally, I express my sincere gratitude to the chairperson, faculty members, and research scholars, as well as MSc students of Department of Biosciences for rendering their help in various capacities to organize this inaugural function. I conclude by thanking Mr. Abhishek, MC of the program, and the convener, Professor Monica Sadanan, who is actually the backbone of the whole program. Thank you, Dr. Monica. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, everyone. Now I request everybody to rise in honor of our university anthem.
ಬೆಳಗೋಕೆ ಈ ಬದುಕು ಎರೆಯುತ್ತ ಜ್ಞಾನ ತೆರೆಸುತ್ತ ಕಣ್ಣ ಈ ವಿದ್ಯೆ ಹೊನ್ನ ಕಿರಣ ದಿನ ಪಾಠ ಪಠಣ ಗುರು ಬುದ್ಧಿ ವಚನ ಇದು ವಿದ್ಯಾದಾನ ತಾಣ ಪಡೆದಾಗಲೇನೆ ಸಿರಿ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ನಮ್ಮ ಅಂಧಕಾರದ ಮನ ಮಂಗಳೂರು ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾನಿಲಯ ಮಂಗಳೂರು ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾನಿಲಯ ನಮನ ನಮನ ಜ್ಞಾನವೇ ಬೆಳಕು ಬೆಳಗೋಕೆ ಈ ಬದುಕು ಜ್ಞಾನವೇ ಬೆಳಕು ಬೆಳಗೋಕೆ ಈ ಬದುಕು ಜ್ಞಾನ ದೇಗುಲವಿ ಬೀಳು ಬಿಟ್ಟಿದೆ ಕಡಲಿನ ತಡಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಅರಿವು ಮೂಡಿಸುವ ಗುರುವೆ ದೇವರು ನಮ್ಮ ಈ ಗುಡಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸಾಧನೆಯ ಮುಟ್ಟು ಮೆಟ್ಟಿಲು ಹತ್ತೋದಿಲ್ಲೇ ಮೊದಲು ವಿದ್ಯೆಯೇ ನಮ್ಮಯ ಹಕ್ಕು ನಾಳೆಯ ದಿಕ್ಕು ಜೀವನದ ಸೆಳೆಯೂ ಜ್ಞಾನವೇ ಬೆಳಕು ಬೆಳಗೋಕೆ ಈ ಬದುಕು ಜ್ಞಾನವೇ ಬೆಳಕು ಬೆಳಗೋಕೆ ಈ ಬದುಕು ಎರೆಯುತ್ತ ಜ್ಞಾನ ತೆರೆಸುತ್ತ ಕಣ್ಣ ಈ ವಿದ್ಯೆ ಹೊನ್ನ ಕಿರಣ ದಿನ ಪಾಠ ಪಠಣ ಗುರು ಬುದ್ಧಿ ವಚನ ಇದು ವಿದ್ಯಾದಾನ ತಾಣ ಪಡೆದಾಗಲೇನೆ ಸಿರಿ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ನಮ್ಮ ಅಂಧಕಾರದ ಮನ ಮಂಗಳೂರು ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾನಿಲಯ ಮಂಗಳೂರು ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾನಿಲಯ ನಮನ ನಮನ ಜ್ಞಾನವೇ ಬೆಳಕು ಬೆಳಗೋಕೆ ಈ ಬದುಕು ಜ್ಞಾನವೇ ಬೆಳಕು
today is to give you a picture of something that is unique in plants. And I choose this plant because I am from plant genetics, but what you hear today is not necessarily restricted to plants, but even animals. I'll trace the events that shape up the plant genomes. What is a plant genome? Plant genome is all the DNA that is present in the cell, in the nucleus, that is responsible for what makes a plant look like plant. So it's a genetic blueprint that is embedded, enshrined, in the form of DNA, organized into chromosomes within the nucleus. So that's the genome. Now we dissect the genome to see what is doing what in the plant and where from these today's plants came. Genome evolution vis-a-vis morphological evolution, the plant evolution, the outer appearance of the plant, and so on. So the summary here is plant genomes expand. They are not static. That is not the case in humans. Our genes, our genome does not expand just like that. It expanded once, but it is not expanding that much now. But that's not the case with plants. Let's see what it is. Even having so much of DNA doing almost nothing, extra DNA assumed to do nothing, but that's not right. I will show you why. So this is interesting question. The variation is a factor of 3,000. Humans, nothing. Plants, by a factor of 3,000 variation, size variation. That is why you, for every purpose there is a plant, for every chemical there is a plant, for every purpose there is a plant, and so on. That is a sense of life. Next slide. Okay, plant genomes are fatty and look obese, but they are not sick, they are really active, they produce, we consume. That's what it is. Next slide. See, when I say obese are not sick, these guys are by 90% they have fat only. But they are not sick, they fight. Plants are exactly like this. They have huge DNA, but they are healthy, they are active, fit, and doing the job. This is the closest comparison that I can see. So the summary is, in spite of being huge DNAs, excess baggage, they're still active, and obviously there is a function for that excessive DNA and excessive variation. Next slide. There are some examples I'll give you. The smallest plant around is just 63 MBP. What is MBP? Megabases. Million base pairs. The total genome size is less than 100, around 63 MBP. The small plant like Genlisia aurea, but you see a Liliaceae plant, that's Fritillaria, you have 125,000 MBP. That is 125 gigabase. So look at the variation, 0.63 megabases to 125 gigabases. That is a variation, which I said. And the largest genome today on Earth identified is Paris japonica, and that's again lily families, and it is about 150 gigabases. Huge DNA. Next slide. So what else is this? When you dissect these sizes, you could see if you plot genome size with the frequency, a large number of plants when it is sequenced, the green you see is dicots, and the red is a monocots. Monocots have much more DNA than dicots. The reason we don't know why. For example, peanut is a dicot, rice is a monocot, maize is a monocot, barley is a monocot. They have much, much more DNA than the peanuts. And so on. So monocots have large genome, dicots have little smaller genomes, and we have general angiospermic DNA. Angiosperms have large, very, very large DNAs compared to genomes, compared to gymnosperms. Next slide shows plant genome. Yeah, here you see interesting fact. Gymnosperms minimum is 2.3 the picograms, 1 picogram is 1 gigabase. And angiosperms are very small, average. But the biggest genomes are angiosperms. So what does it mean? 95% of the angiosperm flowering plants have smaller genomes compared to gymnosperms. But none of the gymnosperms exceeds more than 35 gigabases. Angiosperms, huge number exceeds up to 150. Gigabases. So there is a size variation between gymnosperms and angiosperms, and there is a meaning for it. Next slide. That's what you see. The yellow, the brownish yellow on the left side are angiosperms, and the green ones are the gymnosperms. You see, most of the gymnosperm average DNA is very high, genome size is big, but you see here, as the genome size increases, you see gymnosperms disappear. Only angiosperms shows a flowering plant shows this, and from here there is no gymnosperms. The bigger genome sizes, there is none in gymnosperms. So this dichotomy is very interesting and curious actually, and somebody should work on this. Why these flowering plants such a genome size definitions is there? Next slide. Okay, so this is called a C-value paradox. Just because genome size is big, there is no complexity of functions. I mean, genome size is not proportional to the functional complexity. A plant is a plant. A flowering plant is a flowering plant. A mango is a flowering plant. A small lily flower is a flowering plant. They reproduce. They do everything. All the functions are similar. So functional complexity is not proportional to the genome size. Then the question comes, why then there is that much DNA? How is that much DNA has accumulated? That means some of the DNA has no function, no apparent function. So today we will trace, is there any function to those? And what are those DNAs which are not a bona fide plant DNA, but living in the plant genome? So this is the question that we trace today. So, genome size increase, I told you, by two reasons. One is duplication. Watermelon is a triploid. Okay? Barley is a tetraploid. Wheat is a hexaploid, six times multiplication. So, genome is multiplied 1 to 2, 2 to 4, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5, 6, goes on. So, this is the one major cause of genome size increase, but there is something else. In that, other than that, replication of invasive DNA. There are episodes of invasion of plant genomes by viral-like sequences. They are integrated viral sequences. They move from somewhere else into the plant genome. If you are infected with adenovirus DNA, adenovirus in human beings, within 24 hours, it makes more DNA than what you have. But that's not permanent. Most of it doesn't go into the chromosome. It goes out, metabolized out. But in plants, somehow some viral DNA has got in and stay put. They're not moving out. And they are co-evolving with the plants. And evolution goes up. Then these sequences accumulate and chromosomes, plant genome becomes bigger, 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 bigger as these sequences are adding up in addition to tetraploid. Next slide. Yeah, so genomes of related organisms often strongly different size. Okay, your genomes, any two different people coming from different castes, different religions, different areas, don't differ more than 0.01. But here, plants belonging to the same genus, plant belonging to the same family, differ in their DNA sizes. So within the species, evolution is occurring rapidly within the related, because very closely related organisms like maize, rice, they are all sisters. Maize, rice, millets, sorghum, jowar, all these. But these are showing huge size variation. That is not because multiplication of DNA, because of these invasive DNAs coming from outside, and they are permanently sit there. You cannot distinguish between these DNAs with the other unless you sequence them and nail them down. You just can't differentiate them. Next slide. Okay, so basis of the size. What is the basis of size variation? I'm summarizing here. What makes plant genome fatty? I'm asking the question. How the heavy genomes are evolved and sustained? If they're not sustainable, they won't evolve. They're gone. So, but they are not gone. So, something is keeping them. Is the genome expansion of plants a unique phenomena? It appears to be. Is the plant genome made up of only plant DNA? How much of plant is a plant actually? This question comes. Human beings, 70% of your DNA is not directly human DNA, it's microbial DNA. So that's the question comes, how human is human? Most of you is microbial DNA. So don't scold people with, calling this fellow is a monkey-like fellow and all that, jump like monkeys. Monkey and you differ only by 2%. So you are scolding yourself when you are scolding somebody with the name of monkey. A rat, 85% similar with you. So don't scold a person by saying he's like a rat. You are scolding yourself, okay? So the plants is much more close among themselves. So are plant genomes still expanding? That's the question. The answer is yes, they are expanding. But the next question, is the expansion perpetual? It goes on without control? No, there are control mechanisms within the plant. I will show you one, how it restrains the...
So plants therefore are very plastic, highly flexible, and amenable for manipulation. That is why you can make plant for every purpose of yours. Whatever you want to do with plants, you can, basically. So, now, let's proceed further. So, coevolution, but you need, in order to prove it, I need to show you, we have to have a model family. The best model family for such analysis is grasses. Grasses are really God's gift for geneticists and humanity, because all human beings on earth depending on grasses, because more than 70% of your food comes from grasses only. What else? Maize, rice, barley, wheat, sorghum, millets. All these are grasses. 90% of your calories come from there only in vegetarian societies in Asia. 90% calories come. For others, non-veg, chicken, mutton, and all those things. But indirectly, those also depend on grasses, because a sheep has to eat grass. Or cows or bulls, they have to eat rice, grass. So I chose today Gramini family, the grass family, to prove the concept, to explain how genome is expanding, evolving via expansion, and restrained via restraining mechanisms, not allowing perpetual evolution, expansion. Next slide. Yeah, here you see the genome sizes of these plants, only cereals. You see that rice is the smallest genome of all the grass, all the sisters. Other sisters of rice, all other grasses are very large. You see the sorghum is almost double, maize is almost 7 times, barley is much more, wheat is the largest genome. And compared to that, the brassica ones, that is the cabbage cauliflower family, they have about 1130 megabases, and cotton is 2400 megabases. Those are smaller than grasses. So this is the size. But look at the genomic duplication. Rice has duplicated the genome 32 times. 32 times genome duplication from the origin to now. And look at cabbage, that is 288 times duplicated. 288 times duplicated during evolution. So this is a phenomenal duplication, chromosome multiplying, genome multiplication, and so on. And the least one is rice, of course. As the genome size is bigger, of course, more duplications will occur. But this 32 times is not becoming 64 times now. It stopped there, because there is a restraint mechanism. Next slide. This is what the chromosomes of a small plant, Arabidopsis. Very small plants, about 1.5 foot height. But it's fully functional, flower, plant, seeds, everything normal, root, stem, everything. Look at what happens here. This is a summary slide. This is the chromosome. It has n equal to 5, so 5 chromosomes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, on which DNA is replicated, DNA is there, arranged, genes are arranged. Look at the tip of this chromosome. One is duplicated in here, chromosome number 4. And this gene on the chromosome number 5, this portion of the chromosome is replicated and moved to the other side. So duplications of the genome is occurring within the chromosome, between chromosome, within the organism. Within the organism. There is no gene, there is no block anywhere here, which is only represented once. Look at this big one, this yellow of chromosome 2, this whole chromosome portion replicated, duplicated in chromosome 3. And here the red, it is duplicated here, from there straightforward, 1 to 5. And some from here to there, and there to here, and here first it duplicated here in this region, and then moving to that region. So there are chromosomal pieces, bits of chromosomes are duplicating, DNA is added up within the chromosome and between chromosomes itself. So do you really think Arabidopsis is a diploid? Not. There is no diploid plant on this earth, no true diploid on earth. They're all segmental polyploids. Portions of the genome, portions of the chromosomal blocks are replicated once, twice, thrice, four times, and so on. There is not a single real, true, 100% bona fide diploid plant. This is a radical suggestion, radical conclusion, but that's true. That's what is true. So these are all ancient polyploids. Even the Arabidopsis, simplest organism. Now look at the other one. Next slide. Next slide shows. Look at this again here. Oh, this takes time a little bit. Now the power came. I think power came now, yeah. Okay, so that section is different now. You can concentrate on what I'm saying. So what I'm trying to say is bits and portions of the genome are replicating left and right, duplicating left and right, and they are moving to different positions. I can understand duplication, but how are they moving from chromosome 1 to chromosome 5? Our left portion, short arm of the chromosome to the long arm of the chromosome, positional shifts, how that thing is happening? Just diploids, just multiplication doesn't allow that. So there is a mechanism in plants. Some bits and pieces of chromosomes are moving across genome, either on the same chromosome or to the different chromosome. This is the essence of plant genome evolution, that there are a fraction of genes which can jump around. This is radical theory. This was discovered by McClintock, Barbara McClintock, the only woman Nobel Prize winner in genetics forever, as on today. She discovered this class of genes called jumping genes, or mobile chromosomal segments. They just move. This is against the genetics theory, Mendelian theory. But she explained, nobody understood when she did this in 1942. She became belligerent. She became frustrated. The whole society was against her in US. She was from Cornell University. She stopped publishing. But her work recognized for Nobel Prize in 1982. 40 years it took for others to understand what she was saying. Okay, I was fortunate. I'm really fortunate to work with her for a few days. Nobody can last with her. She never produced a PhD. No students, PhD students. Nobody could tolerate her speed, her arrogance, her disappointment, frustration. So, but greatest scientist I have ever seen in my life. I've seen many Nobel Prize winners when they visit us every year. Hyderabad University honors every year a Nobel Prize winner, every year. So she discovered this. Nobody understood. But some of us, my PhD was on jumping genes. So we understood that we could feel that there is something moving. And it took a special test to catch when these genes are moving. And while moving, they're taking bits and pieces of the chromosomal DNA. So a gene jumping from chromosome 1, it's taking the chromosome 1 portion and putting it onto the chromosome 4, chromosome 9, and so on. So this shifting of the chromosomal segments was radical. And that allowed the plants to be very flexible, very flexible. If you do that in humans, you will get into Down syndrome, you will get into mental disorders, and so on. If a chromosomal piece just keeps moving from place to place, you get into sickness. Not in plants. Not in plants. So this is what I... this is what I want to show. So in maize is an organism of choice for McClintock. She did that maize, and of course, my PhD was also on maize. We thought that is only in maize, but not so. 10 years later, it was found in rice. It was found in datura, in petunia. Almost any plant that you take, any plant you pick, it was showing such kind of mobility of the genes. We now analyze, I will show you how these genes move and how they make the chromosome bigger and bigger and bigger. It is like this. You have a chromosome like this, some piece of jumping here, so the consequence is this becomes bigger. Another jump, little bit more bigger. Another jump, little bit more. So continuously during evolution, chromosomes are extending, expanding, and genome size is increasing. So this is the central theme of this talk. And now what remains now is to show the proof for this and approach, methodology to test this mobility of genes and expansion of the genome. Yeah? Highly modified through human interventions. Then we can trace the history of what happened to the different components of the genomes of these grasses and how they are increasing their size. Next slide. So these are the four plants. Rice on the left, rice, wheat, maize, barley. These are the ones that I'm going to dissect today, and the millets on the down, some millets here. The plant genome, all of these genome, all of these plants share the same gene pool. There is no new gene here that's not present here. But when if I say that, then you can ask why they don't look alike, like you and me. They don't, because the genes are similar, genes are same, but alleles are different. Alleles are different. Genes are same. The loci are same. We can prove that by very many tests. But alleles at each locus in each of these species are different from each other. So, but the genomes are not made of only these four plants, five plants, but major part of the genome is because of these viral origin sequences, DNA elements called transposons, RNA elements, and viral elements called retrotransposons. So these are the elements that make these genomes bulge bigger and bigger. I'll tell you what these elements are a little later. Next slide. Yeah, all these are grasses, but they share same gene pool. Thousands of them, 10,000 families exist, 10,000 species exist in this. But they all, almost all of them, share the common gene pool with great diversity at the allelic level. Okay? So that's the summary of this. Next slide. Yeah, here again, the sizes, rice. This is, I don't know how many times. This is about 1,000 times bigger rice to compare to wheat. So this is size that's flattening, fattening. Ultimately, you end up with wheat, which is the fattest genome that I can think of among the cereals. Next slide. But the gene number does not change, OK? Gene size varies 100 times bigger within the species, within a genus or within a kingdom. But gene number is same. Maize, rice, wheat, barley, the real gene number does not exceed more than 37,000-40,000. So genes numbers same, but DNA varies very high. So most of the DNA that is present in the plant genomes is not genetic. You understand always saying that DNA is genetic material. That means it has genetic information to code for RNA or protein or something. But here I show you that best part of these plant genomes are not coding for, it's not genetic DNA. It is these sequences that make up. So that's why gene number remains more or less similar, but DNA size varies. Next slide. Okay, no, go back. Here you see evolution. 70 million years ago, the Poaceae ancestor came with N equal to 5 chromosomes, just 5 chromosomes. Yeah, then after this became, this ancestor split into two, Panicoidae and this Polidae. Now here you see this chromosome duplicated, the genome duplicated, and then two nested chromosome fusions occurred, bits and pieces of 2-3 chromosomes joined together and made two different more chromosomes, and that's why N equal to 12, N to 5 to N 5, so duplication and addition of two chromosomes here. This is the intermediate ancestor of all these grasses. Now, then again one more split came. After two more nested chromosomal fusion occurred, C4 grasses on the right,
and all the others on the left. That is about 48 million years ago. You have millets, sorghum and maize split into this. The distance between maize and sorghum, jowar and makki, is only 13 million years. But on the left side, you have rice, wheat, and the ancestor brachypodium. This is this is 5 chromosomes. This is 2N equal to 42 wheat, and here 2N equal to 24. This 2N is actually 6X. Okay, that is hexaploid. The common bread wheat, the bread you eat is a hexaploid. So this is how the evolution occurred. That is the time gap. This is not theory. This is calculations based on mutation rates and evolutionary rates and so on and so on and so on. That now that this is happening, we know now that all these share the same ancestor, therefore same gene pool more or less. And along the line, there are duplications and lateral invasions of foreign DNA into them. And that's what the present grasses are, present cereals are. Next slide. Here you see again, this is the brachypodium, simplest of grasses. This is wheat, rice, sorghum, maize. Rice has 12 chromosomes, sorghum and maize 10 chromosomes, wheat 7, brachypodium 5. You see, earlier I showed you within Arabidopsis, chromosome 1 portion went into chromosome 5, some portion of chromosome 2 went to 4. This is different. Here you see from rice genome is in between. From rice you see this chromosome number 1 is chromosome number 3 in maize. Chromosome 1 also, a large amount of chromosomal piece came from there into sorghum, chromosome 3. So chromosome 3 of maize and sorghum are duplicates. So you could see this happening across all these sister species, sister plants. Maize, sorghum, rice, they all look alike. At the seedling stage, you can't differentiate between maize and sorghum, and rice and wheat and barley at the seedling stage. They're similar because they're the same ancestor, same genome. But you see how the chromosomal pieces, I can understand this duplicated here. This is an intra-chromosomal duplication, 1 and 2. But you see here, this went to chromosome number 8 or 7, and that went to chromosome number 3, and again chromosome 1 of maize. So what is happening in between these, or the genomes are evolving, the flexible genomes are evolving, and they jump from one species to the other, one genus to the other, one order to the other. So how this is happening, how this can happen, and what are those sequences? Next slide. The proof came when linkage maps were constructed for rice, maize, wheat, sorghum. Here you could see, this is the rice, this is a foxtail millet, this is sorghum, the green is sorghum, then the pearl millet, then maize, and so on. The chromosome 1 is similar to this chromosome of maize, foxtail millet, and this is sorghum. So these are aligned, chromosomes are aligned one after another very nicely in this roulette. What is interesting is there is a domestication gene called shattering. Earlier, grasses shatter their seeds and they grow by themselves. You don't have to plant seeds for grass, they just grow by themselves, shattering. The shattering mutation occurred in rice, so rice grain, today's rice cannot shatter, then otherwise farmers would have lost everything. You wouldn't have anything to eat. The shattering is gone, but when that gene is located on rice chromosome, similar area is located in all of these sisters. That is, chromosomal order is preserved across these grasses, which differ by 70 million years. 70 million years, the chromosomal organization remained more or less similar. This is what we call chromosomal syntony and gene collinearity. So the chromosomal syntony remains 70 million years. Then what is changed? What is changed is the lateral sequences that are addition and deletions of lateral sequences. Next slide. So when dissected out, this is the summary what it shows. Brachypodium, there are 50,000 elements, that is retrotransposons, viral DNA. 50,000 of them, and that makes about 23% of the genome. Class 2 DNA transposons about 5%. You come back to maize, you see what it is, 1,130,999 copies. This is 50,000, this is 1,000,000. 76% of the genome is made by these viral sequences. What remained in maize is just 25%, that's all. The maize DNA, bona fide 100% maize DNA in maize genome is only 25%. Rest of it either viral DNA, retrotransposons or DNA transposons. This is really startling, and this happened. Okay, next slide. So we call them as a transposable elements, that is DNA elements. These are retrotransposons. So this is exactly same story repeated here. So the summary is, substantial portions of the plant genome of among these species genome is not that of plants. It is coming from viral origin sequences and some unknown other sequences called DNA transposons. Okay, next slide. So what is this transposable element? How these transposons jump around? These are the double stranded DNA, the DNA transposons I'm talking. This is the one which is discovered by the McClintock, not the molecular biology. Molecular biology waited for 40 years to come. Okay, so here you see what is interesting is in this. This is called SPM element for which she got Nobel Prize, this discovery of this. Here you see a transposable element is a piece of DNA. It has a gene in between that's called transposase gene. And now you see a terminal inverted repeat, this one. That is, you read upside down, it exactly same. Okay, terminal inverted repeats. And then there's a flanking direct repeat, A-C-G-T-T-T, a direct repeat here. So these are the direct repeats, indirect repeats at termini decides a gene to jump around. That is, if you take any double-stranded DNA, any piece of double-stranded DNA, add this sequence on the right, these two, and these two on the left, that starts jumping. That will move from one place to another. And not only that, when it moves, it takes adjacent portion of the chromosomal DNA into some other place in the same genome. This was what was happening. She discovered this when DNA is not known as genetic material. People thought it's protein that is genetic material. Yet she said, in the genetic material, that's a polymeric genetic material, a gene cuts out, some element cuts out, a monomeric element cuts, and then it dissects, it dissociates into monomers and jump into some other place. Roundabout saying the double stranded DNA is single stranded breaks and then moving and all that, she understood that. And that's why nobody understood. It took that long for her. Okay, so what is this element in the first place? This element is not just a piece of DNA, it is an element. What it does is it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 exons, 4 introns, and there is a STR here, there is another STR here, and there is a TIR, terminal inverted repeat, terminal inverted repeat. The length of this element is about 4,565 base pairs. If I take this out from maize, put it in rice, it starts jumping in rice. If I take this out and put in gerbera or in cabbage, it starts jumping there too. So that's why these are called finally mobile elements. This is not just a gene, it's a mobile element. It doesn't have the integrase excision enzymes. Only one enzyme it has, it does both functions. But where from the DNA mechanisms come, where ligase comes, where excisionase comes, they come from the host. So it will utilize the host and jump around, cut the chromosome where it wants to jump and inserts there, that's all, lands there, that's all. Okay, next slide. That is DNA transposon. That cannot make up more than 5 to 10% of the plant genome. But the bulk of the 95% of that DNA is from these elements. Retrotransposons. Retro means they exist as RNAs, RNA to DNA, DNA to RNA, then proteins. So this is a very elaborate, very invasive RNA. These are integrated viral sequences, progenitors, and they jump into plant, and they cannot be in the virus form in the plant. Only DNA exists, and that is embedded in the chromosome as if it is plant DNA. Now look at the structure of this. This has major components, two ORFs it has. It has a long terminal repeats on both ends. I will show you more. They move through an RNA molecule that is reverse transcribed into DNA. So RNA to reverse transcribe into DNA, and DNA back RNA, RNA to protein. And that's how it keeps moving. But what inserts is DNA, not RNA. Okay, it's DNA. So we have both kind, long terminal repeat and non-long terminal repeat. Line is a long interspersed nuclear elements, this one of these. and then there are short interspersed nuclear elements. All kinds of these are mobile ones. Some are permanently sick, disarmed elements, they can't move anymore. Most of them they don't move anymore once stabilized. And there are mechanisms which I don't have time to explain today, the restraining mechanisms of these jumping genes. Next slide. Okay, so what is it made up of? This is a transposon DNA, I showed you already McClintock element. The retrotransposons are two kinds, long terminal repeat elements and non-long terminal repeat. Long terminal, 300 nucleotides on the left, exactly repeated on the right. It has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 genes. And these are GAG, POL, envelope genes, polymerase ones, and envelope genes and so on and so forth. And there are one, they don't have anything of this, this is called olive element. I mean, these elements permanently stuck. It cannot move. Once it jumped into a plant or animal, it's just stuck. These are a large number of them are there in human beings too. And these are L1 element type, ORF1 exists, ORF2, there are two proteins, but important genes, POL, GAG does not exist, so it just cannot jump out. So we have elements that are active, mobile, jump around. Those elements which are not active, not mobile, they cannot jump around, but they just sit. But that by sitting permanently there, genome size is expanding. Next slide. Okay, so this is summary of these elements. You have maize elements. In maize, there are three types of really long stretches of DNA. Copiarator transposons have everything, RNase H, RT, reverse transcriptase, integrase, protein binding site, GAG site, and protein binding site here, and the PPT site on the other, LTR, 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 GAG, but you see here what happened, INT moved here. That became a gypsy. Gypsies are known for nomadic tribes, they keep moving, no? That is why they call gypsy elements. Okay, so here one thing happened, INT went here, just jumped around here, this becomes a different element. And this is much completely different. This is not an element, this is a virus. From here it jumps here, all you need is this one gene. If this one gene is added by crossing over, this becomes a virus. So you have mechanisms. If the virus becomes aggressive, if the retrotransposon becomes aggressive, it will become virus and it kills the plant. Just like any adenovirus in you and me. So most of those are not this. Most of them are not this. Most of them are these. Okay, gypsy element and copia elements and so forth. Copious presence is called a copia element. Gypsy means keep moving, that's called gypsy element. Next slide. So transposons and retrotransposons make up more than half of the genome in many plants. That's the problem. The fattiness came from there. That's the summary. Also found in many other organisms besides bacteria. Diverse families, they exist, just not one kind of jumping genes, families of jumping genes. Highly repeated. Repeat sometimes million times. And dispersed across the genome, there is no specific place where they are attracted to. They disperse across the genome. They can insert into the exons, they can insert into the introns, they can insert into the 5' untranslated region, 3' untranslated region, spacer regions, and they can insert into enhancers. Everywhere in the genome, they're dispersed, they can jump in. What happens when a transposon jumps into a promoter region? Can you guess? The gene is switched off, right? But no mutation. It just jumped into promoter, stopped transcription. In fact, the Mendelian genetics, the round and wrinkled gene, you must have remembered, round is dominant and wrinkled is recessive. That's not a mutation. Big transposon jumped into the round gene and the gene is switched off. So it appears, it is like a mutant. So many of the plant's genes, many of the plant recessive genes are transposon insertions in them. It is something like 20,000 nucleotide big sequence sitting into the 2,000 nucleotide sequence of the round gene. It is like a lorry sitting on Maruti car. Can it move? That is exactly what it is. Disruption of the gene function. Okay. And these are small and large sequences, you have all. Ancient guests or invaders or selfish or junk, we don't know what they are. But they are not just junk. That we know. If it is junk, plant would have rejected it. Mobile in nature, cut-paste methods, including ligase, involving ligase, DNA polymerase, DNAs, and so on. And RNA-mediated transposition, the intermediate structure is the RNA structure. So that I have no time to discuss today with you with regards to retrotransposons. Next slide. Yeah, if you take from Arabidopsis, it's a little small genome, very small genome, 138 or something, from there to the barley, which is 15, which is barley is about 5 billion nucleotides, 5 billion. As the genome size increasing, the red, this is a transposome DNA. Most of the DNA, most of the genome of barley is made up of only red. It starts most blue, that means most authentic plant DNA, a little bit of red one, that is the transposons. As you go by, genome size increases, and you have all the transposons added up. So my theory is gene expansion, evolution is by gene expansion, not just genome expansion, not just polyploidy alone. Polyploidy is only size increase, but variation comes from these transposons. Because they will be jumping around, they create mutation. Mutations are the basis of variations, and variation is the basis of evolution. No variation, no evolution. That you all know. Next slide. Okay, this is what happens. If a normal crossing over occurs, nothing happens. The genes will be same. Now, there is no danger there. Nothing lost. Nothing lost by a double crossover. Only the gene order changes. Chromosomal order changes. But if the intramolecular, this is a transposon sitting direct terminal repeats, a transposon, the red one here with the two blue ends, this can trigger this kind of a structure, and during replication, meiosis, this will be out. Because there will be a crossover, no centromere, this will go out. This is how the this is how to restrain a plant genome expansion, getting rid of the transposon. So it is auto-destruction mechanism that the transposons have it, some of them. On the other hand, if it is this side, if it is this way, here again same structure in the chromosomes, but inverted repeat termini. This terminus looking 5 prime, 3 prime, this is looking 3 prime, 5 prime. This can happen, crossing over occur here. What is happening here? Is there any change between this and this? No change.